تكبيره ونؤمر به وعز وجل. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. We turn to Allah, begging for His assistance and asking for His forgiveness. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is the mighty and the sublime. I bear witness openly without hesitation or reservation that there is nothing worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Dear beloved Muslims, we greet you on this day of Juma with the greetings that all the ancient worthies use from Adam to the day of Assalamu Alaikum. In this Juma khutbah, in this Juma talk, we're going to deal with the Khalima Tayyib and the Khalima Khabitha, that which is the word which is wholesome and the word which is corrupt. You know the Khalima, the Shahada Tain, that means two parts that we make when we become Muslim. Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. The Khalima Tayyibah, the good word. This is no mere just seven, eight words with no meaning. If it has no meaning to you, maybe you don't understand what it means, and we're going to try in the course of this khutbah to say some words about it. If it was sub-zero weather out there and you just holler, coat, shoes, heat, nothing would happen until you made an effort to get these items. It was real cold. So the words have meaning. When you bear witness, you see something. Ashadu. I see something with my own intelligence, with my own akal. You know, when you the word when you say eat, akhala, but you say intelligence, akhala, the ayin. So it's a difference. They sound almost alike. If you want to say he ate, you say akhala. If you want to say intelligence, akhala. Almost imperceptible differences. What is the eat? And what is your intelligence? Your innate intelligence. And your mind has a mouth too, and a knife. So you will have to be able to feed off the words and carry these words into practice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu awfu bil uqud. All you who believe, fulfill all obligations. So we as Muslims must fulfill all obligations in our lives. Words make people. Try to think without words. They're very important. So, dealing with these very important words. Ever since from day one, you had that war between al-haq and al-batil, al-haq and al-batil. Truth and falsehood, truth and falsehood. That's an unending battle. So it's important that you understand the words that you make. It's not about coming to a mosque and saying a few words that have no meaning, no effect in your life. So when you come to the kalimat tayyibah, the good word, it has meaning and effect in our lives. Now you know, this word, we hear this expression.
The word of God.
And a lot of people are saying these expressions today. But how are these expressions understood by the Muslim?
The word of God.
The word of God is not God. The word of God is His will and His amr, His command in the creation. So some say, oh, in the beginning was the word, yes. In the beginning was the word, and then they say the word took on flesh, it became flesh. No. In the beginning was the word, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, kun fayakun, be and it is. This is Allah's will and His command. When Allah wants something, He simply says, kun fayakun. Your word, my word, is different from Allah's word. The word of God is not God. The word of God is the command and the will of God. So, Hindu philosophy says, well, the word of God is God, so God can be manifest in this concrete here, in a cow, in a snake. That's Hinduism. Or God can manifest incarnated. This is also Hindu philosophy. The incarnation concept. God incarnated down into a man. This is false word. Allah exists alone. And in the most authentic source of the Muslim, it says, Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Allahu samad. Allah is eternal. Allah is not matter. Allah doesn't have to become a roach for you to understand what a roach is. Become a man before you understand what a man is. Or look for some female to impregnate with a son. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. Allah is neither begotten nor is He begotten. Crazy notions talking about God was born. What a crazy idea. You want to be intelligent? Intelligent. You want to use your akal? Listen to the words. Study the words of the Khalim Tayyib. You don't come to this religion blind. Taklim? No. You have to see something. You don't see it? Alhamdulillah. Pray for guidance. Then maybe you see it and you say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan. I want to be a Muslim. So these ideas, these concepts that are so prevalent today, these concepts, God's word, you hear a lot of people, oh, they get wound up. Red and chicken wing, oh boy, they get wound up with this. My God is a wholesome God. And then they say nailed to a piece of wood. What a crazy idea. No. Allah is free of His creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, highly glorified is He, needs nothing whatsoever from His creation. We need this creation. You can't think, you can't do anything without Allah. But Allah in His beneficence, in His mercy, give you the opportunity to use your akal, to use your intelligence to think. Inductively and deductively. Allah could have made us all look alike, and what a sad place it would be if we all looked alike. Or Allah could have made us all think alike, could have made us all obey, do what we're supposed to do. Allah could have done this. But He leaves the human being free to make choices. And with His word, with His guidance, with His huda, man staying on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path. So, Allah has said in this Quran, let us read. A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajeem. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. أن لم تر كيف ضرب الله مثالا كلمات طيب طيبات كشجارة طيب أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء. صلى الله عليه. With the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Seest thou not how Allah sets forth a parable? A goodly word, the kalimat tayyib, a goodly word is like a goodly tree whose roots is firmly fixed and its branches reach to the heavens. Tukhti, tukhti, ukulaha kula, kulahi, bi'idni rabbiha. It brings forth fruit at all times by the leave of its Lord. Wa yadribullah, wa yadribullah, wa mfala linas. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. So Allah sets forth parables for men in order that they may receive admonition. So this good word, Allah sets this parable forth, that this good word, this كَلَّمَ طَيْبٌ, this good word, you know, when you make your declaration before the Muslim Gumbadi, you take the good word, the kalima. You say, Ashadu, I bear witness. And this word is like a tree that bears fruit in all occasions, all seasons. It will work for you. This is the parable that Allah makes for us. When you see what that means in your life, when you see the love and the mercy that Almighty God has for you, and when you look at the tree and the seed, you know, the seed, even when you say that, just like you say, Ana yuhibbuk, Ana yuhibbuka, I love him. Ana yuhibbuki, I love her. Hug the seed. The seed. You say seed, hug, and you say love the same way. Grain, seed, hug. So this mercy and this beneficence that Almighty God give you with understanding this word. Because when you say this, when you get the meaning of it, you say la. It starts off with a negation. La ilaha. No, there's nothing at all in this creation that I should bow down to and worship. Not my wife, not my job, husband, children. Some people bow down for all kinds of things. It becomes their ilah. So they don't have that tree. They can't get the nourishing fruit from that kind of tree, from the tree of God's beneficence and mercy. So when you see what this produces for you in terms of direction, in terms of the ability to make a choice, isn't this what morals are? Isn't this what ethics are? The ability to determine what's good for you and what's bad for you? That's what morals are. That's what ethics are. So you have a criteria in this Quran, a means by which you can make a judgment for something that's going to pay off for you. With luscious fruit, a grain, a seed that's going to grow and grow with God's love and God's beneficence. And you know, some trees and some shrubs, they start off with a seed as well, but because of the seed doesn't have the substance, it can't command the air, the sun, the water, and the nourishment to bring about fruition and fruit. Some little shrubs, you pull them up from the root, nothing there. No matter what they do, there's nothing there. But when you come into this religion and receive the beneficence, you say, La ilaha. Nothing is worthy of me to submit to as a human being but the Almighty that created all human beings. It put each and every one of us on equal footing with any human being in existence and out of existence. That's a dignified position to be in. If you have something, you know, some people aren't gifted with something, little money or something. They even walk different sometimes.
Yes, I matriculated in Harvard, and I'm
a... some person that had this or that. You'll find little peculiarities about what they have.
Oh, yes, I live on this side. Where do you live, by the way? What's your education?
They'll tell you. Well, a little air, whatever. But we say, we're not threatened. We say, alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed you. Now, what are you doing with what you have? What are you doing with the blessings and the love that Almighty God has blessed you with? So this kalima, tayyib, is a word and a declaration that will pay off for you with luscious fruit. And you say, La ilaha, no deity, nothing is divine but the one who created all existence. And divinity simply means you're not in need of anything. Only Allah is divine. So you see a human being, regardless how honorable he might be or she might be, they can't be God. Well, what about Jesus? What? No, Jesus is not God. Jesus, alayhi salam. And see, even when we mention Jesus' name, we say, alayhi salam, may God be pleased with him. But Jesus is not God. His likeness is that of Adam. This is a dignified religion. So the khalim tayyib, this word should bring about change in the human being's life. If you take this shahadatain and nothing has changed in your life, do some serious, serious self-reevaluation. Because over a very short period of time, there should be some significant changes in your life. If there aren't, maybe you don't understand what the words mean. Allah says, وَلِكُولٍ وَجْهَةٌ هُوَلِّهَا فَاسْتَبِكُوا خَيْرًا. To each is a goal to which Allah has turned him. So strive as though in a race toward all that is good. So you come into the kalima tayyib, I come into kalima tayyib, we in competition for the good. I'm competing with you. Oh, I can be more effective in this area. I can do this for the Muslim community. You can do that for the Muslim community. So we in competition for the good. Not how many 40 ounces we can drink, or how much dope we can take. No! We're in competition for the good. Because Allah is good and accepts only good. And this is what Allah has instructed us. So our talk today, dear Muslims, is about the khalima tayyib and the khalima kabith. So this idea of khairat, what is khairat? Khair is those things that are beneficial, those things that are wholesome, those things that are necessary in your life as a human being. The excellence that brings about the excellence in the human being, the beneficial thing. Business. What is this saying? This is saying the good things are things in business. You want a business? You're qualified to have a business. Qualify yourself. Seriously engage yourself in acquiring business. It's often said about this religion that this religion, the inclusivity of this religion, it includes everything, every aspect of the human being's life. This religion covers it. That's in business. You should be striving to qualify in business. You shouldn't want to be stupid and ignorant. No, you want your akhir to grow in many, many stages and stages of khairat. In technology, you want your technology, business, science. When we have Muslims say, this is religious knowledge, we don't say, this is religious knowledge, this is scientific knowledge, or this is material knowledge. Knowledge is knowledge to the Muslim. We don't make these distinctions. You want to be all spiritual, and you don't want anything. And spirituality, the Muslim that practices religion, they don't say, oh, you too spiritual. No, you're a Muslim when you practice what's required of you. And it's sad, as the story says, that the most persecuted man in the judgment would be the learned man who has not received the knowledge of God. This would be the most persecuted man in the judgment. Allah's knowledge covers all spheres of man's endeavors. You walking around like you so tough. And somebody else taking care of your responsibilities. Someone else feeding your family. That should make the Muslim feel very bad. Say, this is a bad position. This is no position for the Muslim to be in. Not after I've taken my shahadatain. Not after I've taken the kalima tayyib. No. Somebody else feeding my wife. If I feed your wife and I'm constantly feeding and putting roof over her, she will be my wife. It's just simple as that. You don't want nobody feeding your wife. You want to feed your own wife. And if the welfare department would tell the truth, many people would get mad. Them ain't your women. The black, my black woman, my girl. Them ain't your women. Shut up. I'm feeding them and taking care of them. Shut up. So the Muslim don't want to get in that kind of position. He wants to grow in every sphere of excellence and development. And every one of us have the opportunity to do that. So this khalima, this declaration that we make is very significant. It's not just a bunch of words that have no meaning. How are these words going to impact on my life? The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has said, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, has said, that the male that does not marry is not one of us. Now, this is not saying one that's not looking for a wife. I don't have a wife. We want to make this clear, because a whole lot of people are looking. It's not that they don't want a wife. But the one who makes that declaration, I ain't getting married. Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say the one that takes this position is not one of us. And really, you don't have social life until you get married. It will force you to come into your manhood. Allah has said that the male, the man, is the qawimuna ala nisa. He is the supporter of protector, and maintainer of the woman. Then we have this day and time, then you got these women that come out of this strong thing because maybe she's had bad experiences. We like the sisters to be feminine. We like the sisters have been given the rule over the children in the house. Now, this is not to say she can't get an industry and education, no. But she has been given the opportunity, the very distinguished and meritorious responsibility to be the first teacher of society. The new life is given to her to be taught. That's her dominion. She teaches, society learns at the feet of the mother. So more women is going to have to get back to that protection of the development of new life. You know, they had this gorilla that's supposed to run off and save the. They're still writing about it all over the world. Oh, the gorilla took to that. And mothers now are going to drop the baby off in a dumpster, keep walking. They don't present it what has happened to the human being in terms of reducing the human being to the knowledge of their own intelligence and what the human being's responsibilities are. So this, Allah has said, Laysa dhakaru kal untha, that the male is different from the female. There are natural differences. And Allah has just given the brother, the male, just a little bit of physical strength above her. Just a little bit. Physical strength. Because when she goes on her hades, her monthly cycle, and she has children, she's in a vulnerable, weaker position. For the man has a little physical strength where he can move about and do things. Allah has done this. Now we know there are exceptions, and sisters lifting weights and taking all kinds of steroids and got all kinds of muscles bigger than the brother. Yeah, we know that. But that's not natural. So this kalima, khalima, tayyib, is very significant. We get tired of words because we don't understand what they mean and the significant impact on them. We should understand that this is an obligation. This is an obligation on every Muslim male and female is to seek knowledge and also responsibility. See, that inquisitive urge, to want to take part, to want to be intelligent, want to take responsibility, grow in all these dimensions. These are necessary adjuncts to human existence. So if you make a declaration, you just want to hide yourself, you want to be a monk or somebody up there, hid away, you don't want to get married, you don't want to take a position in society, that's not our way. And you know, many people have been affected by people who have gone to extremes in spiritual development. Because they look at the ideal spiritual development is get away from the world. Exist on the outsides of human existence. They don't want companionship. Okay, how old you are? You're 80 years old, you by yourself, you wanna be with somebody. So the ideal way is not to be by yourself. Those people that have gone to extremes in physical, spiritual development interpret the world as being the enemy. The world in material development is being your enemy, your adversary. Don't you worry about wealth. Don't you worry about this. You know, when a person tells you not to worry about wealth, what they're saying, don't you worry about food. Don't you worry about clothing. Don't you worry about a house to put to live in. Don't you worry about those things. No. Allah said, don't forget your share of this world. Seek by the means that He has given you this world. But don't forget the final abode. I was about to say hereafter, but even the word hereafter is a Christian concept. It's translated, the Darul Akhira means the final house, the final abode. See, when you say hereafter, when you invoke all these other concepts. So the Darul Akhira means the final abode when you leave here. This is just a training ground for when you leave here. We as Muslims believe in the final abode, the Darul Akhira. You know, in our first experience, we were told there wasn't a final abode. But now we have a Quran. We have direction. We have guidance. Who that? So we know that that term hereafter is a Christian concept, the hereafter. And really, when you translate it, that which comes later, really, you're talking about the future. See, by the means that Allah has provided for you, all this that you see right here now, but don't forget the future. That's what it's saying. It's beautiful. So this idea of seeking what you should want to grow into many dimensions. You should want some money. Oh, we shouldn't have any money. I don't want no money. Look, you should want some falus. You want some peso. You want some rubies. You want some gilt. You want some whatever. All of it. Because we need money to propagate this word. We need money, all kinds of money, to propagate this message. Because we just prepared for the Darul Akhirah. We just prepared for the final abode. But we want to address these things that should be addressed right now. So this idea of being responsible comes from the word masula, sa'ala, which means responsibility. And every time you assume responsibility, also accountability. You want to be accountable. See? Many people stand back because they don't want to be responsible to anything. I don't want to be responsible for that. I got to give up this. I got to give up that. But see, the wise person knows that the reward is going down the Sirat al-Mustaqim. We don't know why we're Muslim. It is Allah who made you Muslim. It could have been some tragedy in your life. And many of you, if you would be candid, or when you began to explore what this Al-Islam is about, something happened in your life. Some kind of, maybe you did a wrong. And it wasn't as fulfilling to you as you thought it was. And said, oh, it's got to be something better than this. I know how I was crazy about that. And I went at it, and that wasn't nothing. Next thing you look around, that person is a Muslim. Oh, my God. It is Allah who makes Muslim. It could have been some tragedy in your life, some ailment, some sickness in your life that spark you to make a decision of which way you were going, which is best, which way should I go with my life. So this idea of Muslim, it is Allah who makes the Muslim. And when he comes to that, he bears witness that there's nothing worthy of worship but Allah. And Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. That all the messengers of God were brothers. Jesus, Abraham, Moses, all of them were brothers. And they didn't have these little silly hang-ups. That only God, only the Creator, Allah, is to be worshipped. Now, what is the Kalima Khabitha? The Kalima Khabitha is the word, it says that it's like a tree that don't bring the fruit. Don't do anything for you. This is the position of those who make the word and declaration that Almighty God needs a helper. Or you got some make the declaration there is no God. Or you have some that make the declaration that there are many gods. This is the Kalima Khabitha. They are so hell-bent. They think that little intercessor, a little intermediary is going to give them the opportunity to just to do all those things with impunity. I can do anything. Just put it on Jesus. Bring every law of human decency. I got a trap door. You know, it's like the judge. He's getting ready to send somebody, man, kill all these people, did all this wrong, and the judge said, wait a minute, you don't have to pay a thing. I tell you what, I got a son about your age. I'm going to bring him out. You sit down there and take care of yourself. I'm going to bring him out, and I'm going to nail him to a piece of wood. And then you can go back home. A judge that does something like that is a foolish judge. Because the one who is offended is the one who had created everybody. You can't take that upon yourself. You didn't create anyone. These things that you call in God besides the one that created everything, ask them what they have created that you call in God besides Allah. Ask yourself, what is it that they have created? They have created nothing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this Quran that everything created has come about either by three ways. Either it came from nothing, either it created itself, or it had a creator and originator outside of itself. Just ask some of them. This is what you call a law? What did it create? You want to be intelligent? Come into this Quran. Yes. So you have to be responsible to yourself first. When you see Allah has given you the knowledge, like all human beings. Then once you come in contact with that, then you want to stay in contact with it 5 times a day. So the idea of standing up for prayer is just not some little empty ritual. It is you are willing to come into obedient discipline in your life. This is what you want to come into. You wake up in the morning, you take your wudu, you state your intentions. You want the environment clean. If you had any expulsion of solids, liquids, or gases, it invalidates your prayer. You want to meet your Lord in a clean environment. You state your intentions, how many steps, how many rakats you're going to do. This brings the human being into discipline life. Now, shaitan, or those who have taken the kalima tayyib, the kalima kabitha, what they have done, they say, you go with that discipline, but we're going to take all of the substance out of what you're doing. So you're making all kind of prayers, and you're not trying to earn any money. You're not trying to earn decent employment. You're not trying to get involved in industry and business and commerce. Take all of that out of you, and you dress up in a long robe like you just got off the desert, and you don't have anything or any hope. And those that have made the kalima kabitha, they sit in these big towers of learning, and they hoard the wealth. But they tell the world, I don't want any of it. And they got all of the wealth. Here you spiritually don't have a dime. And they call the little houses where they learn at seminaries, where you see nothing but the male germ and you don't see the female germ. You don't see life. You can't generate life because there's nothing there but the male germ, the seminary. So they spit the human being, take his substance out. You ain't got nothing. But the Muslims should want to be in commerce. The moon, why? Because Allah has established this creation, and Allah has said that the believer would be the inheritors of the earth.
Allahu Akbar.
So when you look at technology and you look at science, you should want to be a part of that. Allah said that the believer would be the inheritor of the earth. So when you look, you go into chemistry and you look at the periodic table and you see sand. Sand, silicon, nothing but that's the computer chip. The IC integrated circuit is nothing but a piece of sand. But a person had imagination. They had belief and faith. And they took that little simple piece of sand and they know how to cut it and slice it into substrates and send voltages to it and watch the coulombs and the electron flow and store information and come out with so many different computers. But this is what we as believers, God has promised us to inherit that. And we're on the internet now. We returned from New York. We had our annual convention in New York, in White Plains, New York. The light was on in White Plains. I don't think White Plains would be the same after we left. Wow. Seeing so many thousand Muslims making salat out there in the park. The vendors was out and the people had the literature and the making salat at the Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Hundreds upon hundreds of Muslims. 98% African Americans lined up in order rows, making salat, praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's beautiful. We're on the internet now, those who have computers at home. This is the call number, http://www.worldform.com/islam.html. Those of you who have computers at home, you can access the internet and you can talk and you can find a lot of information out. So we as Muslims should want to get involved in every aspect, every sphere of human development. Islam is not this little superficiality, it's what kind of hats you have. What kind of food you eating? Oh, I want some Muslim food. What is Muslim food? Sister's been cooking beautiful 20 years, 30 years, if I remember, and I don't think anybody can beat them cooking. They don't have to put curry in their chicken. These African-American Muslims know how to cook some chicken. They don't have to cook it like somebody else. Sister been cooking for 20 years, all of a sudden now she got all this kind of stuff. You know that we ain't used to eat no chicken like that. I want to smother the gravy. If I want some chicken from somebody in Pakistan, I know where to get it. Got a Muslim. I gotta go to a Muslim country. I gotta go. You Muslim, ain't you? You in this country, ain't you? You're in a Muslim country. Look, dear Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved the Muslim community of a whole lot of sins. Look at the money you will pay before you took the Kalima title. Think about that. Here you were, how many of you were smoking? 99.99% of people who began in this community put cigarettes down. And when I came in, you couldn't eat collard greens, you couldn't eat shrimp, you couldn't eat cornbread. Allah has saved this community from many sins and weaknesses. You smoke cigarettes, $2 a pack, I don't know what they are now, $2 a pack, $2 plus a day. Add that up for 7 days. Then the liquor store. Those that came in this room, put the liquor down. Look how much money that's saving in your payroll annually. And not to mention the pig ears and pig feasts and all that other stuff on the 4th of July. Look what is saving you from your health, having you come into a better health, having you come into many better things. Look at the money you save just by being Muslim. Don't you know it's revolutionary to be a Muslim? And how much of that money is coming back to the masjid? Not for me, but for Islamic endeavors, propagating this religion. We can get anything we want to. We got a jet plane in the first real experience, and a pilot. We got a jet plane, And I got down on one of those jets. The jets are really something. You get on that jet, and you look down, and everything is so, they're lined up, and so insignificant. It means nothing. You way up there in the clouds. We got a jet. Look, think big. Even though you're small, you should think big. This is the way we should think. Think big. Allah has said, فَتَلَقَى عَادِمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَالِمَتٍ فَتَعْبَ عَلَيْهِ. And Adam received a word from God. This is the word that Adam received. This Quran. There's no other way around it. You're going to have to come into the Quran. If you don't have one, get a Quran. This is not a Ramadan book. Book you take down from the shelf on Ramadan.
Yeah, I'm gonna read it on Ramadan. That's when anybody else read it. I think I'll get it out then. Yeah.
Emergency book. Get it out for a prayer. Get it out for a funeral.
Yeah, I think I'll get it out for the funeral. Yeah. Somebody get married, I'll get the Quran out. Somebody done left somebody. Yeah, child, he left me with all these babies here. I think I'll get my Quran and see what it says. Look, you should have that Quran every day. Feed off of the Quran. Take the teeth in your mind and chew into it. I know it's going to be painful for some of us. See, when you're cutting teeth, it gets real painful. The baby go to cutting teeth and rub his gums, get all kind of ice and everything on it. It's painful. And breaking that new teeth in your mind's eye with this Quran, chew on the Quran and see how it'll change your life. It will change your life around. This Quran, dear Muslims, is a logical book, it's a reasonable book, and you want to grow into every sphere coming to the Quran. And that's what Allah has done. Allah has established logic in His creation. That's what illogic means, is sick knowledge. Everybody wants to grow into intelligence. Logical. In the Greek philosophy, they say logos. In the beginning was the word. Yes. Kun fayakun. Be, and it is. Now you can say be and it is all day. Nothing would happen. You have to use what Allah has created from His creation to bring anything about. You can create, but it says Allah is the best of creators. So Allah exists alone, but He has created everything on a pattern of duality. Male and female, up and down, and hot and cold, in and out. It's always a dialectic. But Allah exists alone. So a lot of the professors, they try to trick up the language. They say, well, Allah is the first cause. It's causal. The effect. And it goes around and around in a tautological argument. But Allah in His mercy gives you takes you out of that circular argument. And Allah has no cause. Allah is the creator of the cause. Allah is the creator of the nature. Allah is neither male nor female. It says, say, He, Allah, is one. He begets not, nor is He begotten. And there is nothing like God. There's no comparison. We learn by comparison. But there's no comparison to Almighty God. Dear beloved Muslims, we like to say that the kalima, the ashadu an la ilaha illallah, is just the start. It's an obligation on us to seek knowledge from the cradle to the grave.
And then to take that knowledge and to apply it in our daily lives, in our personal lives, in individual lives, and in our community lives. We're also obligated, dear Muslims, to contribute in zakat. Zakat is giving some of your earnings to the community. In fact, when you look up that word, zakat, zaki, means to grow a thing, zakat, to grow a thing, in purity. And it also means, zaki, means pure intelligence. So your zakat is a requirement, it's an obligation, it's farid on each, it's faridatul, on each and every one of us. It's an obligation to give something in zakat. If we don't have any money, give some of our time. Give some of our talents. It's always a call out to participate in the activities. To give. To give something. So the idea of giving, the idea of growing, coming into the religion, coming into the requirements, is a must. And that's when we understand the Kalima Taiba. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. Kul in asnati wa nusukhi wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alamin. لا شريك له وبذلك أميرت وأنا أول مسلمين. Dear beloved Muslims, in conclusion of this talk on the Kalima Tayyib and the Kalima Qabitha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He would separate the Qabitha from the Tayyiba, that which is wholesome and good from that which is corrupt. There is no force. There's no force in this religion. If you don't, you can't handle certain aspects, pray on Allah for guidance to free you from these weaknesses. This is all of us. We pray to Allah to grow into our excellence as human beings. The Prophet has said the most precious thing is your rational knowledge, your knowledge and your morality. This is what separates us from the animal, the beast. The ability to use our thinking, the ability to use our cognitive ability, and use it in the right way. Because, you know, there's a story about a man, about Zakat. The man said he donated all his money at the end of the year to his wife. She, at the end of the year, donated all her money to him. So they never had to pay Zakat. And they used all kind of little things. But we as Muslims understand that matters are judged by intention. We want to keep our heart clean and pure. We want to participate. This is a participatory religion. This is religion is participatory in all of us. You don't come into religion, say, I'm going to donate some, I'm going to participate. Oh, that imam, he sure preached today, child. No, you have to establish your relationship with Allah. I got to deal with my own situation. So don't be looking at me. I got to deal with my own situation. Ya Allah, please help me. And I do that all the time. So we have to constantly ask Allah for His forgiveness. We have to constantly establish ourselves, grow into every area, every dimension of human development. So without further delay, we want to announce Imam Wafi Muhammad is going to be at Mercy College September the 22nd at 2 p.m. رَبَنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَّنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَّنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ
النَّارِ. الحمد لله رب العالمين. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Maliki Yawm al-Din إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين.
إذا جاء النصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفر إنه كان توابا. الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده.
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. الله صمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
سمع الله لمن حمده.
الله أكبر
الله أكبر
الله أكبر.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
تكمل الله لا يستطيع.
I sit in church, yeah.